Good afternoon. Welcome to today's webinar, Key Elements of OSHA Standards for Steel Erection. Today's presentation will discuss in detail the OSHA requirements for steel erection, which are completely different from any other requirements for the other building trades. Some of the differences that will be discussed are the requirements of a general contractor, the controlling employer, for site layout, site-specific erection plans, and construction sequence. In addition, the presenter will discuss the requirements for hoisting and rigging, structural steel assembly, column anchorage, beams and column erection, fall protection, and training. The presenter for today's webinar is Daniel M. Payne. Daniel is a construction and safety and fall protection expert. He's a certified safety executive and a professional member of the American Society of Safety Engineers, past general chairman of the Construction Division of the National Safety Council, and a member of the Board of Directors of the Veterans of Safety. Mr. Payne is a frequent lecturer on the topic of worksite safety and fall protection. He co-authored the book entitled Elevated Work Platforms and Scaffolding Job Site Safety Manual, and he has authored and produced articles and films addressing elevated worksite safety issues. Mr. Payne has been found qualified to testify as an expert witness in numerous court proceedings, and he has given expert testimony on the subject of worksite safety and fall protection. Mr. Payne has also testified as an expert for OSHA at the public hearing for the adoption of 29 CFR Section 1926, Subpart R, Steel Erection, which is the subject of this webinar. If you have a question that pertains to this presentation, please use the Q&A or chat feature, which are found on the right-hand side of the screen. I'm pointing them out with my red pointer. Dan will do his best to answer your questions during the presentation. Tomorrow morning, I'll send out an email with a link to the archived recording of this webinar, and we do ask that you take time to fill out the survey that will appear on your screen after the webinar is over. I now invite you to sit back, relax, and enjoy. I'm going to turn it over to our distinguished presenter, Dan Payne. Dan, the presentation is now all yours.
Good afternoon, everyone. As he told you, my name is Dan Payne, and hopefully we will have a pictorial view of most of the things we're going to talk about. But let's set the stage with what we are going to do. First of all, pre-planning is a big thing in steel erection, as it should be in anything else, but for the first time we have a standard that requires it. No plan, in my opinion, is a plan for failure, and the planning starts at the design stage. That means with the owner, architect, and engineer, and should continue to the completion of the project. Nothing ever goes smoothly, so you need to have a plan in place for those things that don't go the way you think they should. Subpart R requires extensive pre-planning, and there are controlling contractor issues, structural stability issues, multi-employer issues, site-specific plan issues, new means and methods, which you need to define, new training requirements for the kinds of people who work in steel erection, and new contract issues. Benefits to a contractor are to explore the many different fall protection solutions. Use the contract documents for buy-in and accountability, and avoid costly errors by using last-minute solutions that do not work. That's one of the big things that has always been a problem in construction, is that people make errors because they do it by the seat of the pants. You need to examine the changing means and methods to build in, not add on, safety. Benefits to contractors: with planning, determine the exact cost of your safety solutions. A plan to get buy-in because all participate in the solutions. And finally, site and path specific plans will reduce your costs and improve your experience modification rate EMR and make you more competitive in the marketplace. The objective. The purpose of this presentation is to illustrate the key provisions and requirements of the new OSHA Subpart R steel erection standard. Special note that states that operate under their own OSHA-approved plans must meet or exceed what we're going to see in this presentation. Scope. The subpart sets forth requirements to protect employees from hazards associated with steel erection activities, construction, including alterations and repairs, of single and multi-story buildings, bridges, and other structures where steel erection occurs. Tower erection is excluded from Subpart R, and that could be the subject of another webinar. Same is true of precast concrete construction. Same is true of reinforcing steel insulation, which is not in Subpart R and at the present time is under revision, but in Subpart M. Some definitions that are going to be different, and you can find these definitions in the subpart under definitions, but we'll be talking about constructability. We'll be talking about what a controlling contractor is, what a controlled decking zone is, what we mean by a qualified rigger, multiple lift rigging, safety deck attachment, and steel erection. Okay, let's start out, and I've got them numbered as they would be in the standard. For instance, the first one is 1926.752, and that deals with site layout, site-specific erection plans, and construction sequencing. First of all, you need to get from the general contractor the approval to begin steel erection. This is a letter, and it must be in writing, and before authorizing the commencement of steel erection, the controlling contractor, or the general contractor, must provide the steel erector with written notification that the concrete strength is 75% in the piers, walls, and footing before he starts erection. And any repairs, replacements, and modifications to anchor bolts that have been made. Site layout conditions. The controlling contractor shall provide and maintain the site layout as follows. He must have adequate access roads into and through the site for the safe delivery and movement of equipment. These also should be given notice to both the police department and the emergency vehicles, since roadways and access roads change as a project progresses. Site layout conditions. The controlling contractor shall provide and maintain the site layout as follows. A firm, properly graded, drained area that's readily accessible to the work with adequate space for the safe storage of materials and the safe operation of the erector's equipment. Now, this is very important because you don't want to have an area that's going to move. That is where a lot of accidents happen. You start to lay steel out in an area to shake it out, as they use the term, to move it around, and you don't want it tumbling, falling, and crushing people. Site-specific erection plans. Where employers elect, due to site conditions specific to the site, alternative means and methods can be used to protect employees. For example, you can deactivate safety latches on hooks. You can erect joists in tandem that are over 60 feet in columns. And you can land decking bundles on joists that are not fully bridged and welded, which it says in this particular standard. However, if you're going to do any of these or any other things along that line, you need to have a written site-specific plan showing how you are going to manage the safety and mitigate any of the problems that might arise. Let's talk a little about hoisting and rigging. pre-ship visual inspections of cranes. It requires the cranes used in steel erection shall be visually inspected prior to each shift by a competent person. Now, a competent person is a qualified person when you look in the definitions, which means a person either by degree or training has expertise in the area that we're talking about, and if he's competent, he must be the person who has the right to stop the work where there's a problem, and that means that he must be appointed by the contractor. Qualified riggers. A qualified rigger is a rigger who is a qualified person who shall inspect the rigging prior to each shift in accordance with this CFR 1926-251 standards. They talk about qualified riggers. Other applicable standards are the ASME, the American Society of Mechanical Engineers, B30.9 standards for wire rope slings. Let's take a look at what some of those requirements are. Here's the elements of a rope. And during the inspection process, the qualified rigger must be capable of recognizing the following conditions for removing wire rope slings from service. So he needs to know what the wire is, what the strand is, what the core is, what the rope lay is, and it needs to be able to tell whether or not in any way they're damaged. In addition, 10 randomly distributed broken wires in one rope lay is a reason for removal, 5 broken wires in one strand in one rope lay, severe localized abrasion or scraping, kinking, crushing, bird caging, which means they explode, or any other damage resulting in distortion of the rope structure, evidence of heat damage or corrosion, end attachments that are cracked, deformed, or worn to the extent that the strength of the sling is substantially affected, are all laid out in the B30.9 standard. Questions. Please use the chat or Q&A features found on the right side of the screen to submit your questions, if you have any at this point in time.
Yeah, we're going to open it up for questions. So if anybody has a question, please submit them to Dan. We do have one question that has already come in, Dan, and maybe you could talk about this a little bit more. Could you go over what you mean about pre-planning in a little more detail?
Sure. There are a number of areas that are within OSHA now, as well as within ANSI, that's the American National Standards Institute, that talk about the need for pre-planning and the different kinds of employers or contractors. OSHA uses the term employer because everything in OSHA is between an employer and his employee. Therefore, they use the term employer, but it is also applied across industry boards, but in particular in construction. A general contractor is what they call a controlling employer. And then there is other different kinds of employers. Those are all found in a CPL, you can put that down, capital CPL, 2-0.124. It was put out in 1999, and you will find it on the OSHA page, OSHA.gov, which when you go onto that page, you look for compliance documents, and you put that number in, and there is a 9-page document that explains how these employers are defined, and how you can take a look at them from a legal point of view. They all come from a section in OSHA Act, which is Section 5, which is an interpretation of the term employer from that area, which was done by the Secretary of Labor. This has been through the court system and has found to be legally sufficient.
Okay, great. Thank you, Dan. We do have a question here from Jill who asks, is the rule that you speak of, or the rules that you speak of, are they in effect and have states adopted the rule?
Yes, ma'am. They sure have. And they are in effect, and they've been in effect for over 5 years.
Okay, great. I don't see any more questions in the queue, so why don't we move on with the presentation of content, Dan?
Okay.
Thanks.
Next, let's take a look at working under loads. And this is a very important thing, because you will find that you don't want people, obviously, working under a load while you're erecting steel. So, employees engaged, the only people who could be under the steel during that erection process are employees engaged in the initial connection of the steel. Obviously, they have to be there to make that connection, and employees necessary for hooking and unhooking of the load. Multiple lift rigging procedures. Certain areas, such as New York City, don't allow this as part of their plan, but most areas in the country do. And if you're going to use multiple rigging, which is also called Christmas treeing, a maximum of 5 pieces may be lifted, and a minimum of 7 feet between those members that you see on the screen, and a 5-to-1 safety factor for all the components that are going to be in there, including the cables and everything, the crane, and how it's going to make the lift. And all loads must be rigged by a qualified rigger. Control loading, load lowering must be engaged on all hoisting equipment. Let's talk about structural steel assembly. Planked and deck floors. The following requirements shall apply to multi-story structures. A fully planked or deck floor of nets shall be maintained within 2 stories or 30 feet, whichever is less, directly under any erection being performed. So you can use either a fully planked or deck floor or nets. Obviously, one of the reasons you would use nets is your decking didn't arrive on time, so your secondary plan would be to have nets. And it may be used because of the means and methods that you've chosen to use. It makes more sense. Walking working surfaces. Shear connectors, reinforcing bars, deformed anchors, or threaded studs shall not be attached to the top flanges of beams, joist or beam attachments until after the decking has been installed. Now, this was put in because of the fact, as you can see them putting studs down, that what happens if you put those on top of a beam before you have decking, anyone that's trying to walk that beam is going to potentially get their pant leg caught on it, slip, trip, or fall. Stability requirements, plumbing operations. When deemed necessary by a competent person, plumbing shall be installed in conjunction with the steel erection process to ensure stability. We're talking about plumbing, meaning getting the building square. Plumbing equipment shall be properly installed before the structure is loaded with materials such as joists or bundles of decking. Hoisting and landing or placing of deck bundles. Now, bundles shall be landed on framing members so there's enough support provided to allow the bundles to be unbanded without dislodging the bundles from the support. Now, you can see that you're spreading the load over a number of beams or joists. Roof and hole openings. Roof and floor holes and openings shall be decked over where large openings do not allow for continuous decking. They must be protected by guardrails or other systems. Now, here's something that most good contractors realize right up front, is that you don't put holes in the decking till you need them. Then you don't have to worry about covering them or barricading them and having the possibility of an accident. So the best way is usually to deck the floor and cut the holes when and where you need them. flashing inside column webs. Now you can see the column web is that area between the two flanges where he has his torch. And he's flashing the inside of the column web where the decking and planking did not fit. It didn't fit right up to it. That presents the possible problem of dropping an object or kicking the bolts and other materials through that hole down and hitting somebody on the deck below. Adequate floor coverings to support loads. This is important. If you're going to load a deck, keep in mind that you have a metal deck that's down there. You need, if you're going to put anything that weighs anything, or you're going to have a lot of people working in an area, then what you need to do is to put a floor covering down there that will spread the load. And it must be at least twice the intended load of the workers' tools and equipment. Anchor bolts. This is a big thing, and there's a couple of things I just want to add to it before we get into it, which makes it easier to have anchor bolts in the right place. As you can see from these pictures, the anchor bolts that are just in the concrete that are sticking up, you've got to have that fit perfectly on top of your flange of your bottom flange of your steel. And if it doesn't, well, then you have a problem. You either have to slightly bend it or drill it out. A smart way to do that thing is to use what's called an anchor bolt sleeve, which is a plastic sleeve that can go over that anchor bolt, and you pour that in the concrete, which gives allows you to move that anchor bolt after the concrete dries one dimension of the bolt in any direction, which gives you some leeway. What you see here is all the columns have to have four anchor bolts in them. That's a minimum of four. The columns shall be set on level, finished floors, pre-grounded leveling plates, and leveling nuts or shim packs to adequately transfer the load to the concrete pier or column. Inadequate column anchorage, and you can see from this picture that there's only three bolts, and that was done because the column piers were laid out wrong, and you can't have that. That's a violation of the standard, and that would have to be repaired and that column removed. Anchor bolts shall not be repaired, replaced, or fuel modified without the approval of the project structural engineer of record. That's another reason for probably using an anchor bolt sleeve, because if you're going to bend them or you're going to cut them or you're going to do something else, you're going to have the structural engineer sign off on it. Prior to the erection of a column, the controlling contractor shall provide written notification to the steel erector if there has been any repair, replacement, or modifications of the anchor bolts of that column. Why is that done? Because the anchor bolts are put in when the concrete is poured. Steel erector probably isn't even on site yet, and that's why they also have to tell him when it's 75% cured, because he would have no idea not being there. Okay, the concrete in the footings, piers, and walls must be at least 75%. We've talked about that already. And replacements, anchor bolts, or pulling out of the footing due to the green concrete. And that's what can happen, is that you can get movement or pulling out as a result of having green concrete, which means concrete that's under 75% pure. Here's an example of a column that was pulled out. You can see the concrete on it. It collapsed and turned over. Whether there were four bolts in there or two, I don't know. But the point would be, if you got green concrete, you got a problem. And preventing structural collapses, unstable columns collapse. And here's a picture of what something like that might look like. You can see them. Let's talk about beams and columns. Now, keep in mind that beams are horizontal and columns are vertical. Double connections at columns. That means when you have two columns coming together and you got you have two beams coming together on a column, you got to have, there are requirements for seat lugs or similar devices to prevent structural collapse during the initial beam connections. Coordination needs to be made between the fabricator and the erector. This is an important thing for those of you who don't know the difference. Let me just say this. All fabricators used to be erectors. Today, most fabricators are not erectors. They manufacture the steel and put the holes in the steel and make them of the size and strength that the engineer tells them, and then they in turn usually are the person who hires the erector to erect their steel. This means that they need to work together, because obviously you can't erect a building that has the holes, as an example, in the wrong place. Special training is required for the people doing connectors. Connectors are a separate group of people. They make the initial connection. It's usually two bolts that go into beam and column on each end when they're putting them together, and they're loosely tightened. Then they have another group that comes up, we're called the bolter uppers, and those are the people who come behind them and do finish the connections off. Double connections at columns there's a requirement for a seating lug, an offset connection, or other means. In other words, you put something through the holes to hold them in place while you put the bolts in so you can line them up. Unsafe practice. The use of half pins to temporarily secure the double connections. In other words, you don't stick a pin in there, okay, and secure the connection. That's not the purpose of what you're doing. The purpose is to make sure that the holes line up so you can put the bolt through. Double connections at columns must be provided with a shop or field attached seat or other device to secure the connections. If you want to see the different kinds of seats, there are drawings in the standard, which you can also get at OSHA.gov by going to that site and then going to construction standards and then going to subpart R, which will give you this standard that we're talking about now, plus the appendices, which show you what all the different beam configurations, terminus points, and double connections look like. Column splices. Column splices must be designed to resist a 300-pound eccentric load placed at 18 inches from the top of the column. So when you have this splice plate, you go to the top of that column, and 18 inches from the top of that column, it's designed to resist a 300-pound eccentric load. Now, an eccentric load is any load or force that is applied to the column, such as the connector himself that's going up there. Keep in mind, some of these guys weigh 250 pounds, and they've got a bag of bolts and everything else that's attached to them, so they come pretty close to those numbers. Perimeter columns, that's the ones on the outside of the building. When constructability allows, perimeter columns must be provided with holes at 42 and 45 inches and at the midspan for the installation of safety cables. Now, these safety cables are put up at that time so that when the decking is put down, that gives safety cables at the perimeter of the building, which are necessary for the other people to work. In addition to that, they can be built strong enough so that they will accept a tie-off point, but you need to know that that has been done. Installation of safety cables. Perimeter safety cables must be installed after the floor decking has been secured. This is one way to do it, where you're welding a eye on it, or, which is the tabs you're talking about, or it can actually have a hole that's cut directly through the steel. Open web steel joists. General requirements for steel erection of joists. Steel joists at columns shall be feel bolted to provide lateral stability prior to releasing the hoist line from the joist. In other words, while it's still being held, you do the bolting because you don't want it moving while someone is up there and exposed. Framing joists. Bays to provide stability during erection. So you can see these posts that are holding against that bay wall so that we're going to have some stability of that wall while we're erecting those joists. General requirements for joist erection. The bottom cords of a steel joist at the columns shall be stabilized to prevent rotation during erection. You do that by making sure that you have attached both the top and bottom of that joist. Steel joists and bays of 40 feet and more shall be fabricated to allow for field bolting during erection, unless constructability does not allow. That means by constructability that the building has been designed in such a way that you can't do that. Then you have to come up with an alternate plan like we talked about before, and that plan needs to be in writing. Erection bridging terminus points. In other words, where the bridging is going to terminate. And those different kinds of terminus points are all shown pictorially in the standard. Erecting joists less than 60 feet, and you're going to see that there are different requirements depending upon the length of the joist. Where steel joists at or near column spans, 60 feet or less, the joist sufficient strength to allow one employee to release the hoisting cable without the need for erection bridging. Now, erection bridging is there for stabilization. They're saying that where you have a steel joist at or near a column where the span is 60 feet or less, okay, you don't need to have erection bridging. Where you have a joist that's 60 to 100 feet, both ends of the joist shall be attached. All rows of bridging shall be bolted, diagonal bridging, and two rows of bridging shall be installed near the third point before releasing the hoist line. And only two employees are allowed on this span until all other bridging is installed and anchored. Erecting joists over 100 feet. All rows of bridging shall be diagonally bolted, bridging. Hoisting cables shall not be released until all bridging is installed and anchored. And only two employees are allowed on this span until all other bridging is installed and anchored. Okay, let's talk about landing bundles on open web joists, because you have to put the deck bundles up there just like you would on the roof of a house, and then you spread them out. So, when you put them up there, there's a lot of weight in one place. And so, there's six conditions that must be met which would allow for landing deck bundles on joists that are not fully bridged. First, the employer has determined in his site-specific safety plan that the structure is capable of supporting the load. That means he's talked to the engineer about what the structure looks like and that it's been built in accordance with that and how much he can put up there. Bundles of decking is placed on a minimum of three joists. You can see in this case we've got four, okay? And the joists are secured at both ends. I'll take any questions that we have at this point and go from there. Let's see. Kevin, what are the other types of systems that can be used to mark off holes in the decking? Are warning signs sufficient? No. Where you have a hole in the decking, what you want to be sure that you do is that you have it barricaded one way or the other. Just a warning sign doesn't work. Because of the fact you may back into a hole, it may be dark or at dusk, you don't want people walking into holes. So that's why you have to have a positive means of either a hole cover or a barricade type of guardrail or decking. Let's see.
Dan, I have a question that was submitted to me. Why is the placement of anchor bolts so important?
Well, the anchor bolts need to, what they do is they secure the steel in place, and that allows you to then level that steel column on the foundation. It's not to hold it in place, but to level it and keep it straight. For instance, if the concrete's not strong enough, we know it falls over. But on the other hand, if you don't have all the anchor bolts in and you have one where it's not leveled, it can tip over. The whole structural integrity comes around the fact that you have to have compressive strength evenly distributed over that part of the piers or flooring where the building's being attached.
Okay, great. It looks like we have another question from Kevin. Kevin asks, okay, what types of specialized training is required for connectors? Is there an OSHA certification program?
Yes, what you need to do is you need to go into the standard training, and it is covered in there. I'm not going to go into it in detail, but let me just give you an idea of what it is. I'll tell you what the section is right now. Training is covered in 1926.761, okay? And you have to train all the personnel. They are going to have to receive special fault hazard training, and they have to be able to, they have to know all about the operation of guardrails, including the perimeter safety cables and all the other things that we were talking about, and then special training programs. In addition to the training required in the paragraphs above, the employer shall provide special training to employees engaged in the following activities: multiple lift rigging procedures, the nature of the hazards associated with multiple lifts, the proper procedure and equipment to perform multiple lifts, and connector procedures. The employee shall ensure that each connector has been provided training in the following areas. And then it gives you a whole bunch of those areas, which include the nature, hazards associated with connecting, and the establishment of access, proper connecting techniques, work practices, and as required, you know, by the different sections. And then there's a whole other section for people who are going to be in controlled decking zones, in other words, deckers. Make a long story short, for whatever reason, and we're going to see this in a minute, all iron workers are required to tie off at 15 feet. Connectors and deckers are required to tie off at 30 feet. However, they must be wearing the equipment and have the ability to tie off between 15 and 30 feet. This was done because connectors in particular were worried about pieces of iron swinging into them and them being tethered to something and being hit as a result of not being able to get out of the way.
Okay, great. Dan, I don't see any more questions in the queue, so if you don't have any on your end, we'll probably continue on with the presentation of content.
Okay.
Thanks, Dan.
Falling object protection. Next item that we have here. The controlling contractor shall bar other construction processes below steel erection unless overhead protection is provided. That becomes the controlling contractor's responsibility. General contractor. Fall protection. Fall protection, same thing as in, you got to pre-plan it. The first thing you do in pre-planning for fall protection is you eliminate the fall. And then, after you decide whether you can eliminate the fall or not, then there's two kinds of fall protection, passive and active. Now, let me just talk about passive and active fall protection real quickly and keep it simple. Passive fall protection is types of fall protection like safety nets, platforms, guardrails. Anything that a person can use to protect him from a fall without him having to do anything particularly himself. Active fall protection, on the other hand, is all three kinds, and there are fall restraint, positioning, and fall arrest. Every one of those requires a full body harness, and then it requires a connector, sometimes called a lanyard, from the person to an anchor or anchorage point. And there are all kinds of devices that can be used, such as retractable lifelines, rope grabbing devices, ladder climbing devices, and they all have different types of connectors. However, in all of those cases, the individual has to be specially trained in the means and methods that he's going to use, and he plays the critical role in his own safety. If he has the equipment and doesn't use it, then he's going to fall. Gravity always takes over. So, this takes a look at evaluating your means and methods, evaluating your sequence, identifying the remaining hazards, and determine the best method to use, and pre-plan the installation and training. Under eliminations, you eliminate all the fall hazards, as we talked about. Elimination is the best and safest method to use. Elimination is the most cost-effective. And elimination requires no further planning or training. So that's the way you go if you can. Passive fall protection, usually the best method of addressing hazards, requires little or no training. Once the system is installed, it eliminates the hazards. Examples, you see them. Active fall protection, we talked about it. There's the three kinds, restraint, positioning, fall arrest. All of these methods require the worker to wear a harness and have a connector to an anchorage. Extensive preparation and training are required when they are used. Fall restraint utilizes a harness, a connector, and an anchorage to prevent or restrain a worker from any fall. In other words, it doesn't allow you to get to the edge or fall in the hole. Positioning limits the fall distance to 2 feet or less. Allows for self-rescue. Examples would be positioning for work using hooks and chain assemblies or ladder climbing devices where you would hook off to a rope grabbing device that would follow you up the ladder. So you wouldn't, if you fell, you would only fall a step or two. Fall arrest. This is perhaps the most dynamic type of equipment to use and the most dangerous. You're going to use this in the most severe fall situation. It allows for a 6 foot free fall with a maximum arrest force of 1,800 pounds. Requires extensive pre-planning and training and requires immediate rescue. And it has all sorts of problems. Because of ADA and all the HEPA and all the things that protect people from finding anything out about you, it also prevents the employer from knowing whether you have a heart condition or a lot of other things, which could in fact kill you if you fell and put that kind of force on your body. So they need to make sure you as an individual know that if you've got certain conditions, you shouldn't be using that kind of equipment. Duties and responsibility. It is the duty of management to provide the superintendent and foreman with necessary equipment and training. It is the duty of the superintendent and foreman to ensure that their workers are trained in their task-specific hazards and wear and use the equipment. This is important because lots of times most fall protection training is generic. They talk about safety nets, they talk about harnesses, they talk about rope grabs, they talk about 100 different things. That isn't what you should have for training. Your training should be specific to the job that you're going to be doing. You should know what that equipment is, where your anchorage points are, how you wear it, how you're going to be rescued, and things should be included in that, like not working alone if you got on a fall arrest system, and have the buddy system. Lots and lots of things to take a look at here. And putting together one of these, they're called site-specific plans. Every large good contractor does it in today's world. General fall protection requirements. Now, these are the requirements in there. People who are bolting up, okay, they are not connectors. They have to wear a harness at 15 feet or above, or work out of a lift. And again, the exception would be connecting and decking. We've already discussed they can work up to 30 feet. Same thing's true of welding, and the same exceptions. If somebody was doing a connection off of a ladder, and they were below 15 feet, they wouldn't have to wear anything. If they were above 15 feet, they'd have to wear it, but they don't have to use it until they get to 30 feet, two stories or 30 feet. General protection requirements for plumbing of the building, the same thing. Fall protection during connecting. Between 15 and 30 feet, connectors must be provided with and wear personal fall arrest systems and be able to tie off. We've discussed that. Truss erection, same thing. Bridge erection, same thing. Decking. Now, you can put control lines up to separate a floor between the area that's being decked and anyone else that's working on the floor. If you have up those lines, the only people that can go inside that area are people who are doing decking. And decking are usually the two people who carry the piece of decking and put it in place, and the one behind him who is either doing the welding of the decking or the crimping of the decking. There's a that crimps the deck pieces together, or they bolt them down. You can see there's a guy on each end of the decking. And if they're more than 30 feet above it, they have to wear fall protection equipment. You can see on the guy on the right, if you take a look, that he has behind him a retractable lifeline. Custody of fall protection. Now, this is important because once the steel erector has put all this up and he leaves the job, obviously no one's there to ensure the fact that it's kept in good repair. That's why he should take it down and take it with him if the controlling contractor or his authorized representative doesn't tell him to leave it in place, in which case he becomes responsible for it. Okay, to finish up, We talked about this. Somebody has asked some questions on it. Connecting, we know about. We know there's special training programs. We know there are special training programs for decking. We know there are special training programs for multiple lifting. Any contractor who's in this business needs to have that, and each contractor or union must keep on record all the training that the people who are working for them have received in writing. I think that's the end of this presentation, folks, unless anyone has any further questions. Well, Matt, then I think I'm going to turn it over to you. See if we can find Matt. Let's see. He says maybe I've got some, I don't see any other questions over here. Somebody wants to know the question about the 15-foot rule. The 15-foot rule was put together as an accommodation, I guess. Subpart R as a standard was negotiated, okay, which is not the way they're normally done. Normally they're promulgated and then OSHA puts them out. This had all the people involved negotiating a settlement. This was a deal between the unions, the owners, the engineers, the contractors, and they came up with these numbers, and the 15-foot requirement was to give them flexibility primarily to get out of the way of pieces of steel coming in. If you take a look at most buildings, the distance between two floors between each floor is a maximum of 15 feet, and therefore that gives them two floors that they can work with either having a deck below that or a safety net. And they make exterior safety nets as well as interior ones. So it's got to be part of the plan, and it's got to be put together. And keep in mind, again, that OSHA is a minimum requirement. We didn't talk about this today. We could have a whole other seminar on this, but the whole real fact of the matter is that you take this minimum standard and you make it very site-specific, and you put requirements in the contract documents, and those requirements should be a lot more stringent and a lot more specific.
Okay, sorry, Dan. I was having some technical difficulty with my audio, but I think I'm back now. Okay. Thanks for handling that question. Another question that came in is, how do you determine the proper fall protection system to use on a site?
Okay, that goes into your pre-planning. What you do right up front, as we talked about, is you go through and you do a hazard analysis. It's called a job safety analysis. And you go through and you pick out all the hazards on the job site. If we're talking about fall protection, you take a look at where all the potential falls are. Number one, you eliminate them. Can't eliminate them. Then number two, you see what you can do with the least, the easiest way to solve the problem using scaffolding, decking, all the things that don't take a lot of conscious effort on the part of the individual who's going to be working in that area. And then in the final analysis, you choose one of the active types of fall protection, which makes the most sense in that particular application, and the competent person makes the determination, and then he should talk this over with his workers and make sure that everyone who's going to be using it knows what the hazards are and knows how to use the equipment and how to get themselves rescued. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you. No, it definitely does. And we do have a question here from Catherine who asks, is there a statute that addresses machines hitting something such as a stinger while a worker is welding work on a stinger?
Well, I'm not quite sure I totally understand that question, but let's put it this way. Part of your site layout and part of your erection sequence, and which includes welding or whatever else you're going to be doing, needs to be pre-planned and laid out. And if it's pre-planned and laid out, it shouldn't happen. If it does happen, then something went wrong with the plan. And, of course, that's where liability comes in.
Okay, great. And, Catherine, if you would like to clarify that question for us, we'll stay on the line here for a couple more minutes. Dan, I do not see any other questions in the queue. So do you have any concluding remarks that you'd like to make?
Just the fact that it may sound more complicated than it is, but I think this is a good example of one of the areas of construction, especially I would think that attorneys would want to take a look at, who may or may not be familiar with the sequencing that takes place. But it's pretty easy when you take a look at it to make a determination of what went wrong, because the planning that's required today, both by associations, industry standards, OSHA, and most importantly, by well-written contract documents, there's no reason why work sites shouldn't be getting safer than they are. Not to mention the fact that there is a lot of new equipment out there. I've been involved in buildings now that are being erected, at least one- and two-story buildings, entirely out of lifts. And that really means that there's no need to be out there walking around on open beams and even having the risk of falls. And when you learn how to use a lift and properly place it and properly do your work from it, it's a pretty safe way to go.
Okay. Thank you, Dan. Thank you for a great presentation. I'm going to wrap things up here just briefly. I want to thank Dan especially for putting in the time to the presentation. You could definitely tell that he knows this subject very well. And I'd like to thank all of you who attended today for taking an hour out of your very busy schedule to join us. If you'd like to speak to Dan about a particular matter, you can contact us here at TASA. Our telephone number is up on the screen. You can also go to our website, tasanet.com, and fill out an expert request form. We will be sending out the link to the archived recording of this webinar tomorrow. I'll include in that email a copy of the PowerPoint presentation that Dan used during the program. The archived recording will also be posted in the TASA Knowledge Center. That's found on the TASA website. Just click on the Knowledge Center tab on the homepage. And if you have any follow-up questions or comments, you can email me at mhide@tasanet.com, that's mhide@tasanet.com, and I'll forward any questions that need to be answered by Dan on to Dan. Otherwise, I will take your comments and, you know, use them for future programs. Thank you again for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you at future TASA events. Thank you.
Good afternoon.